So, hello everybody, and welcome to this live session with Luc and Stéphane, the teachers of the Pharo MOOC. Donc, bonjour à tous et bienvenue dans cette session live avec les enseignants du MOOC Pharo, Stéphane et Luc. Stéphane n'est pas encore là pour le moment, il nous rejoindra dans quelques minutes. So, Stéphane is not here for the moment, he will join us in a few minutes. Et pour commencer, une question. Donc, vous savez que vous pouvez utiliser le chat Discord, le channel MOOC, pour intervenir en direct. Et on voulait tout d'abord savoir si certains d'entre vous ne parlaient pas anglais. Donc, merci de nous le signaler dans le chat si c'est le cas. Sinon, ça nous simplifiera les choses de pouvoir faire l'intervention en anglais uniquement. So, I remind you that you can use a Discord channel to ask your questions during the live. And now I will let Luc answer some of the questions you ask in the discussion forum or present you some elements he wanted to. And so,
So
Luc.
thanks, Christelle. So welcome, everybody. So I'm really happy to be here. So I hope that you enjoy the MOOC. So first of all, I would like that you ask questions. So I went through the questions that you gave in the forum. And what I suggest is that I will give some detailed answers with some external pointers directly on the forum, like that everybody will have an answer on specific stuff that he asks for. And today I prepare something to go back to the roots of Pharo and what is really important regarding the syntax and etc. So what I prepare, this is a small demo of how to code a kind of Java doc. So on the forum, a lot of students ask for a Java doc, a kind of Java doc, but for Pharo classes. And in my point of view, it makes no sense because in the Pharo IDE, we have everything to directly ask questions on classes and etc. and get all the information from the Pharo IDE. So what I suggest is that I can show you how to code a small kind of Java doc directly in Pharo. So it was my plan. But if you have some questions, you can ask them on Discord and I can first answer question regarding the whole MOOC. So if you have suggestions or whatever. So I see a lot of people connected, but so this is in the MOOC channel of Discord. So I don't know. I will try to read and follow there. Otherwise I will proceed and share my screen. Okay. One question from Fad. So I would like to know more about Pharo plus Seaside. Ah, yes, but if you want to know more, so the idea is that in the week, so we are starting Seaside in the week 4 in the World MOOC. So I don't know if you already follow these videos. And we are following then in week 5, week 6, etc. Through the tiny blog exercise. So probably you can have a look at that. And then if you really want more, there is more, of course. You can go on Pharo, on the Pharo website, in the documentation part, there is a book section. And in the book section, there is one free book, which is named Enterprise Pharo. And inside this book, it's fully dedicated to web stuff. So you have a lot more details on web development in Pharo and Seaside, of course. So I suggest that once you finish the MOOC or during the MOOC, you go for this book and you read it. I don't know, probably I can provide the link directly on Discord if you want. Where are my books? So this is books.faro.org, and this is the Enterprise Faro, a web perspective. So I provide the link. So the link is in Discord, and you can get the PDF for free with everything inside. So other questions? So let's continue. I will share my screen. Okay. So, oops. So here I'm in a Faro image there. So this is the image that you have for the MOOC. This is exactly the same image. So basically, in the MOOC, you already saw standard tools. For example, the playground. So if you click, if you do a left click on the background here, you have the world menu. Inside this menu, you have a lot of tools accessible. So you already saw it in the MOOC, but I will go back through simple things first. For example, the playground. So you can type expression here. So 1 plus 1, and you can right click and you can say do it. So if I click on do it, I will not see anything. Why? Because it has been correctly executed, but the result is not displayed. So I should do print it to see the result. Or even better, I can inspect it. And now there is another tool in Faro. We can inspect every object in the system. So it means that I can inspect this small integer. Okay, so I can go further. I can open a system browser, Nautilus. Okay, so in Nautilus, as you already know, there is a lot of packages there in the first column, and then for one package you have some classes here that belongs to this package, and then in the third column you have the protocol. So here I can select, for example, another. I will go in the object class. So this tool, this is PostSpotter. Probably you already saw the video about this tool. So this is a tool for searching a lot of things inside the Faro IDE. So it means I can look for everything. So for example, for method names, for class names, etc. So here I'm looking for the object class. So Nautilus is directly open on this object, on this class. I can see all the protocols of method in this class. For example, all methods dedicated to accessing fields or things inside an object. So here, method add, etc. We have a lot of methods in this protocol. So this is a standard tool to code, to develop a program in Faro. Okay, so now my idea for this session was, a lot of people ask for Javadoc, a kind of Javadoc, but for Faro. And to me, it's a nonsense in Faro. And I will do two things in this session. So I don't know if you already had a look at this lecture. I think this is a lecture. So this is in week 3, sequence 4. This is a simple HTTP application in Teapot. In this lecture, I explained a little bit how to build a small bookkeeping application using the Teapot library. And here we will just reuse the Teapot library, but to do a kind of web doc. So how to do that? So we can start with the snippet of code. From here, we can say, okay, we will create a Teapot here, and then a Teapot, we can give some things like that. Okay, let me do the copy paste. Oops. Okay, I will get everything. So basically, I will put it inside the playground. Okay. And we can have a look. It works. Ah, yeah, my copy paste didn't work that much. Okay. Hop. Oops. And I will re-explain the syntax for this example.
Luc, est-ce que tu peux essayer, si on va t'interrompre, de changer la couleur de thème de ton navigateur, enfin de ton éditeur? Ça passe pas très bien sur YouTube, c'est un peu flou la résolution.
Le blanc?
Ouais, certains disent que peut-être sur fond noir ça passerait mieux. Je sais pas si c'est possible à faire facilement.
Oui, on va faire ça. Qu'est-ce que j'ai fait?
It's true that the resolution on YouTube is not the best one.
Je vais le relancer. Hop.
Et j'en profite pour vous dire que Stéphane nous a rejoint. So Stéphane has joined us. Hello Stéphane. Welcome.
Hello. Ok. Ok, is it better from the front point of view?
Si tu peux faire plus grand les caractères, ce serait bien aussi.
Ok. Alors, est-ce que je peux faire ça? Normalement, oui. Par contre, on va... I think it will be difficult to see all characters now, but okay, we will see.
Thank you.
Okay, let me 2 seconds. Okay, so the idea is to start with a simple teapot application. So let's start with a teapot. Let's go back to this guy. Teapot. Okay, we will change the port. So the idea. So for those that didn't watch the video on Teapot, so the idea is that this you can browse this class. So this is a library that is already loaded inside this for image, the far web image for the MOOC. So the teapot library is dedicated, if you look at the class comment, this is something that is built on top of the Zinc server, and it is dedicated to build simple API, web API. For example, it will launch a server, okay, on a specific port, and then each time an HTTP request using the GET method is received by the server that comply with this schema, it means that this will be answered by the server. And so we can test that, for example, if you want. So here, by default, we say we can remove JSON. We can say OK. So we have a teapot, and each time it will receive the slash schema, it will say hello world. Hello world. And we will start the teapot. So let's try that.
Caractère, Luc, apparemment.
Yep. Yeah. Okay, j'ai plein de caractères. So this is errors due to copy paste. Okay. So now, yes, OS X say, okay, do you want to launch connection? Yeah, of course, I want. So now I can test directly. So I have an inspector on my teapot. And here, so this is port 8081. Oh, hello world. So it works. Okay. So this is cool. So we can create a web server with specific URLs. So the idea is that we will do that in a class because we don't want to code directly in the playground. So let's create a class for that. So we will add a package, webdoc. And we will call it webdoc. Okay. So the idea is to create a teapot. So when you instantiate, so here I would like to replace all of this code by something simpler, like I would like to have webdoc new. For example, I would like to have something like that instead of everything that is above. So what can we do for that? So this is my simple server, for example, and I can start it. So it means that I need to instantiate this class. So now I define correctly this class, okay? But I need to initialize this server. And so it means that I need to move all of that in the initialize method of the webdoc. So I will create an initialize method. This is something that is executed each time. Oops. So each time I define an initialize method on a class, I do not forget to send the super initialize. Okay. And then I can store directly the teapot configure like that. Okay. I will declare an instance variable and I will categorize. Okay. So now, what can I do with that? So the idea is to start the server. So when I start it, I will add here, I send the start message to this object. So I must define the start method. So because if I execute that, it will not work. I will get a debugger. Since my webdoc here, if you look at the stack, so this is another tool of Furl. So here, if you look, I executed that, the initialize method has been correctly executed, and then the start method is not understood by this object. Okay, so this object, this is a webdoc object. Okay, so I must define this method. So I can do it directly from here, from the debugger. Here I have a create button. I can do create. I will create define start in which class, in the WebDoc class. So for now, this is not in which protocol I want to define this class. So I want to define it in the starting stopping protocol, for example. Okay. And now what should I do inside this method? But for example, I will take exactly what I had before. I will do tpot get, okay, something like that. So remember tpot, this is the instance variable of my webdoc object. So I can save, I can proceed. Okay, it works. So now I can remove all of that. Have something simpler. I already built my first class of my application and I can inspect it directly. It's there. So this is an inspector. So this is a webdoc object, an instance of this class. And there is one instance variable, which is a tpot. Okay, I can refresh here. It works. We can change the code, for example. We can say, okay, hello, followers. Did I change something? Should I stop? Where is it? Oops, I will change the port like that. Okay. Initialize tpot configure initialize port 8080 tpot get. Ah, I forgot the start. Okay, hello followers. Okay, good. So now, if I want to do a webdoc, so the idea is that I would like to be able to display all classes in the system on a web page. So how can I do that?
So yes, this, how, Luke?
This is easy. So let's start simply. We can say, okay. I will change that, all of that, hopla. You can say now, if I ask for slash in my application, I will render all classes of the system, Okay, but this method does not exist, so we will create it. So how can you know all classes of the in the Faro image? So this is easy. In fact, if you look here, I can check in the playground. If I do, for example, object, and I inspect that. What is object? So object, so this is a class, okay? This is the object class that I can inspect like a regular object. And I can ask this class for its subclasses. Subclasses, for example, and if I inspect that, I usually use key bindings, but if I use it, you cannot see it. Inspect. So here I have an inspector, and what I get, this is an array, a big array of all classes that are subclasses of the object class. So for now, it will be enough. So it means that I can get all subclasses of the object class. So what I would like to build now, this is a string, a big string, with the names of all subclasses of the object class. Okay, so how can I build this kind of string? So we can do it directly by concatenating strings, but it's not very nice to do that. The better way is to use some stream. So I don't know if you already follow the lecture on stream. So I will ask the string class. To stream its content. So I will up the string content. And if you look here for implementers, so probably you don't know these messages. So let's go in analyzing suggestions implementers. So here you can see implementers of string contents. No, this is not the right one. What did I do? String contents. Yeah, this is this one. Oh, okay. So here you see in the sequentiable collection. So this is a superclass of string. There is a possibility to create a stream. It means that it is an object dedicated to insert some object in this collection. So it means in this string without doing a lot of concatenation. Okay? So here we get a string. Okay, and inside this string, and I can use some specific method like this one to put some contents. For example, hello. Or directly object name. So this is name or class name? I do not remember. Let's try. Name. Yep, object. And if I do class name, object class. Okay. So name will be enough. So if I do that, you see here when I do slash. In the start method, when I will ask for slash here in my application, 8080, it will directly execute this code. Okay? So I should probably implement a stop method. Tpot stop. I will add a stop method inside this one. Hop, to stop my tpot, and in the comment, I will do it like that. Yes, stop. Okay. So is it better? No, so I did a mistake somewhere. Steph, if you see the mistake, where is it? String. Get slash start under all classes. What happened? This is not what I expect. So where did I do a mistake? Under all classes. I don't know. Something wrong. Okay. So I don't know. Probably I didn't clean that much teapot. I forgot to trash some instances. So I will take care now. Okay. So let's go back to the code. So what I did that now in the start, each time I ask for slash in my application, I will get this method executed. And inside this method, I will build a string. And I would like to build a string with all classes names in the system. So here, for now, I just put it the name of the first class. So the idea is that I can iterate directly over all classes in the system. So subclasses. Do. And I can say, okay, so a stream, so self render class a subclass. Class in a string. For example. Okay. Ah. Okay, so I iterate over all subclasses of the object class, and for each of them, I will use another method to render it in this stream. So now I have a class, for example, and I will say, okay, a stream. So we can put some tags, for example, I can put ih1. So it will not be valid HTML. Huh? I will say the basic version. I will do the basic version directly. So a subclass name. One. So this is teapot, and teapot does not offer nice support to directly generate HTML. That's what we must do it by hand here, but you will see in C-side it will be much, much easier to do this kind of things. Okay. So we try here. Okay, so now I refresh the web page, and we can see that we have a lot of classes that are directly there. So probably we generate everything for all classes. So now we can see that it's not really in nice order. We can put it in alphabetical order. So all subclasses, we can sort it. So as I don't know if the default sort block assorted collection. Oh, we can sort by name. Okay. Assorted collection. We implement that. So this is in collection converting. Unsort collection whose elements are sorted. LG, what did I do? Ah, yes, because we cannot compare directly classes. So it means that we need to do that with a name. So this is collection. This is, I do not remember, this is sort block. This is what I was looking for. So it means that I can provide a sort block. So sorted collection. Oops. So here's a sort block. I will add classes inside this collection. Okay, so I can compare two classes. C1 name, C2 name. And we can put it as string, perhaps, if, in case this is a symbol. Okay, and go back there. If you do not follow, or if you have questions, you can ask them in the forum. I will try to go a little bit slower. So here. Okay, so I will do like that. So if you look at it, I created a sorted collection. And I said, okay, this collection will contain some classes, and to compare them, you can use this block. Okay, so this is a block that takes two classes objects, and you can compare given them, given their name. And then I will add inside this new collection all subclasses of objects. And then I use this collection to iterate over. So here, if I go there and I refresh, you will see that all classes are now sorted alphabetically, directly. Okay? So we can do better. For example, what we could do now, we could say, okay, I would like that each class name would be a link. And when I click on it, I would like to have the details of one class name, of this class. Okay? So I would like to change that with a link. Okay, and I would like to be able to see what's inside the name. So here, if you look at it, I generate some headers in HTML. I can inspect it there, inspect. So here you see this is H1. So I don't want to have H1 now, I would like to have links. So I would like to have a href. Okay, something like that. Up. So be careful, you need to put double. I will put it like that. Tuck. Okay. And the idea is, what should I put in the href as a detail of a class? It's difficult. What would be the URL of that? So I will do something simple. For now, I will directly use the name of the class. I will say, okay, the href will be the name of the class. Okay, I did some mistake with the quotes. So let's go back. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay, like that. So you see this one, it will print, this is one quote inside the string. Okay, so since I double it, it will be inside the string. And the same here. And the href, for now, I put it that, but I will add the slash, for example, here. So it means it will be slash the name of the class. This is the URL that I will point to have the detail of one class. And here this is A. Okay. And now if I re-render, so nice. I have things like that. So probably I should put, I will put it in paragraphs just to have it in different. Okay. Okay, yeah. If I click on this class, for example, look. Ah, now we can see that this URL is not found by our server. And why? Because here in Teapot, we never said something for that. So how can we invent a new rule here to get to display the content of one class? So let's do it. And it will be the last example in this tutorial. So how to do that? So in Teapot, so I will copy paste the solution and I will explain it. Okay. So here, what I do is that I will answer the get method also, and here I will put a placeholder. Okay, this is a variable that I will get directly from the request. So inside this request, so it means that each time a URL like that with this pattern is received by Teapot, this block will be executed. And inside this block, we will analyze the request. And inside the request, we will ask for the parameter class name, which is a placeholder for this part of the URL. Okay, we will store it in class name. And then class name, as class if present, we will get the class. Okay, if you look at this method, you can do implementers on that. And here, this is a method defined on string. Okay, that get a block. And it returns a class with the given name, the name of the receiver. Okay, so it means that you can do something like string as class if present. See inspect, I can inspect it, and if I execute that, up, I inspect the string class. Okay. So here, see, this is the name, this is the real class object that corresponds to the name that was passed in the URL. And here I will implement a new method which is named render class. So the idea is to render, to generate a new answer, a new web page specifically for this class. Okay, let's do it. So I will do it there. And for example, what can we do on this class? So the same, we will generate a string. So let's do it like that. Okay. And we can just display the name of the class for now, and we will see that we can do more. H1. Okay. So we can go back. We can click on it. Ah, yes, I need to restart it because I changed the routes. So I need to restart the Teapot server. This is why it does not work. Okay. So the problem is that I didn't. Okay. So now when I click on the class name, I can display his name, just its name. I can do more. For example, if I want to display all methods that are defined in this class. So the idea is that how can I retrieve the method of a class? So given the string class, for example, can I ask this class for all methods it contains? So methods. Ah, yeah. So here, if I send methods, the methods message to a class, I get an array. So here, with all methods implemented inside this class. Okay, and if you click on one, so one object in this collection, this is a compile method. So this is an object that represents a method in the system. Okay, and inside this, for this object, for a compile method, for example, you can ask for the source code, if I remember correctly. Yeah. So I get the source code. So it means that we have all the basic blocks to build tools or to build web docs directly. Here, so we can do it like that. We can say, okay, we display the name of the class, and now we can iterate on all methods of this class. Methods do. So this is a compiled. This is an object, and this is a compiled method. Okay. And here, for example, I can display the name of this compile method. If I ask for the name of it, yes, this is string hash. Okay. And I will display it. It's smaller, I don't know. I will put in, okay, Ellie. Ellie. I will put some UL, another list. Okay, UL. And if I refresh now, so what did I miss?
Un point après name.
Where is it?
Compile method name.
Compile method is here.
Yeah. No? Ah non, 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 c'est vrai que c'est pas comme ça. Non, 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 c'est moi qui dis une bêtise. Un point après, non, non plus.
So wait, tac, 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 stream. Ah yes, I mess up in the... No. Here. I missed a dot there. You were right. It was a dot problem. Okay. So now, in my application, so I have the list of all classes in the system, and for each class, I can click on it, and I can have all methods implemented on this class, the list of all methods. And I could go further. I could now say, okay, I would like to have links for them, and I can display the code source of them, or I can do it in the full web page. I can do a lot of things directly. So I think I will stop there because it could be long, but I would like to show you a version that I did before, but I went a little bit further. I add some styling on it. So I just wanted to show it to you. So I will just restart it. Okay. Okay, so on this version, I just did some styling. So here, this is a list of classes in the system, but I did some indentation for the subclass relationship. So this one is a subclass of this one. And if I click on a class, I added the protocols. So this is two methods belong to this protocol. And for each method, I render it in a nice gray box. So you can do easily. I think it's three methods more from what I did so far. Okay, that's it. So,
Luc?
Oui.
You see, what I think is that would be nice. I don't know, I was not there at the beginning, but you show how we can do a Java doc,
yeah,
but people don't want to code that every day.
No.
Now what they should ask themselves, this is why these guys are showing me that and why they don't have one on the web. So what could be nice, this is to show that we have the senders, implementers, and all this stuff that are in the system.
Yeah, I did it during the during the development. No, not before. I did it during the development. So the idea is that, in fact, we don't need really a Javadoc, because a Javadoc, when I'm here, I cannot say, oh, I would like to see the definition of this guy. It's impossible. A web page, this is something that is static. You cannot say, I would like to have the definition of this guy. I would like to know all classes in the system that implement this message. And you can do it directly from the system. If I'm somewhere in the code, I would like to know all classes that implement this method. So here you can go in suggestions.
Luke, I have an exercise because there is one guy. There is one guy that would like to know how we can load a fuel stack. So I have no idea how to do that.
No, I don't know either.
Yeah, but I don't care. So you know what we could look? We could look for the dot fuel. A string dot fuel or fuel in lowercase to see if we can find a method that contains it.
Okay. So here, this is in code search.
Yes.
And you can do method source with it. So this is a little bit long, but it will analyze all source code of all methods to know if it contains this string.
And then after we can use the finder to check fuel or something like that. Ah, maybe Thorsten knows. But this is fun, like that we can. So you see in Faro, you have a cross-referencer because like that we can know super fast which method is sending what message and things like that. And yes. Then we have a full source code. Yes, you see. Fuel stream strategy. So that's for writing. Can you open the? By the way, you see there is fuel out stack debug action. So this is the one that serializes the stack, for example. Can you click on the fuel out stack debug action? So this is the code to serialize the. Where is it? Where is the fuel stuff? Serialize the stack, debugger, interrupted context. Yes, so apparently this is typically the what has been added to the debugger to serialize. Now to load the stack, I don't know. So yes, if you can debug, Luke.
So is it there by default? I do not remember.
You can go on the normally if you go on the menu. Oops. If you go on the menu, Luke.
I'm there. Inside this one?
The menu on the
yes, it's there.
Yes, I don't know why this is there. It should be on the main stuff.
Little but, icon here.
Yes.
Here it's a file out stack. Yes. And now probably it's there on my it's there. So probably if I close it, okay. And probably there is an action to get it. External stack. Debug. I never did it, but I was expecting that someone took care of it for me. So yes, it works.
So this means that after we should look at the drag and drop because we can find the code that loads this stuff.
Yeah, probably there is a code to say, okay, how to load it directly. Okay, so as I said in the beginning of this video, I went through all questions that you ask in the forum and I will probably I have a lot of external references to pass, so external links and chapters, etc. So we will probably put it directly on the forum, like that you will have answers. So other questions? So yes, the idea of the Java doc or the web doc was to show that it's easy to build and you don't really need it since you have all the tools that are already live there in the IDE. So it means that every time you ask yourself a question, you can always, for example, if you want to know all classes that implement this message, so as we said, this is implementors. So this is there, code search, implementors of it. So this is extremely useful. So you know all classes in the system that implement this message. And then for one message, you can say, okay, I would like to know all senders. So it means all methods that send this message. So here you have the list of all methods that contains the message sent with this name. So this is really, really, really useful. And much, much more useful than just a static web page that is easy to build.
So I can answer a question. So you see one guy ask what Thales is doing with Faro. So in fact, Thales, there is a group that is doing the software for that is embedded into the aircraft. And what they do, and many other kinds of things like that. So what they do is that there is a team that is doing the requirement engineering for the UI, and they prototype. So in fact, this means that during their contract, they prototype the user interface and all the functionality of the application with a professional Smalltalk, and they want to change to use Faro because they want to have multi-touch. We develop for them multi-touch support, and they really want to use the new generation graphic system that will come probably in Faro 8. In fact, during 10 years, they developed a system that is similar to Block, and then we work with them so that they will migrate to Faro.
Okay.
I'm reading what the talkster was mentioning.
So have you other things to add, Stéphane, Luc?
Yes, I have something to add, is that Faro, this is what we have now. This is what I said in one of the video. And if you have suggestions or if there is something that goes wrong with your installation or things like that, please report. We know that there are sometimes problems, and this is really important that we get this feedback. So, you know, we are not like, oh yes, Faro is the best system in the world. We are building it every day and we are improving it. So our goal, this is really to improve Faro. We know where we are going. In fact, this is in the future, we will have really a small kernels of Faro with a completely new graphic framework that can be completely autonomous. We want to have a better integration with the OS and things like that. So we know where we are going. This is just an engineering problem because we are an open source for real. So, and then what we are doing is that we are really making sure that companies can make business with Faro. So this means that's why there is the consortium, and that's why also we should pay attention to not break everything all the time. So what we are doing is that we have a consortium so that company can put money on the table to pay engineers. So like that, we can move a bit further.
Yeah, I wanted to go back to one question. One question has been asked. So how can we contribute to Faro? And the question was a little bit the other way around. It was, yes, I know it's an introductory course, but I would like to know how to contribute. Yes, of course, you can already contribute. This is really easy. There is a bug tracker for Faro, and then you can go on the bug tracker. You can read bugs. The first thing that you can try to understand bugs, and then you can try to reproduce them. Just reproducing bugs, this is good. So you can say, okay, let's try in the latest Faro, because now for the MOOC, you know, you are using Faro 5. But there is Faro 7 that is under development. So it means that you can try to reproduce bug in Faro 7 to see if it works or not, if the bug is still valid or not. And then the next step is that you can try to fix a bug or to propose a fix. And for that, there is some tutorials on the web. You can go in faro.org/contribute. I think there is a video and there is a tutorial that explain how to contribute. And if I remember correctly, I will put the links in the answer.
Luc, maybe this is the old one now.
Yes, I know, but Guillermo Polito did a nicer version.
We should produce a doc out of that.
Yes, I already asked to put that in the Faro contribute page. So you can already have a look. And you can already improve simple things like class comments, like, I don't know, write some documentation, whatever you want. We are really an open community and we welcome some.
So for example, some simple action. You see, the problem is that when you are good in Faro is that you don't look anymore at the method comment and things like that. And I started, because I have sons that are pair programming with me, I started to realize that what was super obvious for me was absolutely unclear for them. So I started to look at the class that are like array and the basic class in the system and look at the comments and said, oh yes, they are not good enough. And I started to improve them. Or also methods like simple iterators that we use every day, I started to add some example inside. So using this chevron thing so that our example can be executed. And those are really actions that are, you don't bring any bugs in the system. So this means that normally you have no stress. And adding comments and things like that, this is really nice. And it means that what is important is that if you do something, we will take care. So in fact, in Faro, we do not think, oh yes, no, this is a simple bug, so it's more important to fix an important one. Yes, this is important to fix an important one when this is damaging everybody. But most of the time, we pay attention to every single contribution because we believe that the simple contribution, if we do thousands of them, then you will have a better system that you will be able to make the larger ones. So from that perspective, you are really welcome. And you can really have an impact on Faro from that perspective.
Okay, thank you. Anything else? So just to remind you that there will be another live session on the 20th of November. So we will, don't hesitate to tell us what you want to be dealt with in this next session, how you want it to be done. And yes, we will adapt.
And don't forget that we are trying to be present on Discord, but you have also the community, the people in the community, they're nice, they will answer your questions. And don't hesitate to ask.
And we thank them a lot.
Wish I could try, but now, but Faro crash on this computer. Ah, pay Discord. And this is really important to report. So how to report a problem? Because you should always say, okay, this is the version of the OS. This is the version of my system. This is also, because sometimes on Linux, you have different kinds of, multiple kinds of OS versions and the version of Faro that you are using. And this is really important to report that. Send a mail with this information in the mailing list. So Christelle, yes.
Yes, so I'm answering in the on Slack, on Discord, sorry. So for the next session, you can just post a message for the next live session, a message on the forum, and so we'll have this message to prepare the next session. Your suggestion, sorry. So thank you.
Thanks.
I think it's...
Yes, thank you.
Yes. So see you on the MOOC forum, on Discord, and on the next live session.
Yes, thanks a lot.
Okay.
Bye. Bye, everybody.